This is the second video of a Q&A series, and I have received many questions. So let us start with the ones which we have. Kali Prasad Rai from Noida has asked this question, and it is, why the first restriction endonuclease is named as HIND2 and not HIND1? The question has many other points also, but for nomenclature of endonucleases, the rule is very simple. Suppose we write Haemophilus influenzae. This is the name of the bacterium from which the endonuclease is obtained, and its code is RD. So the rule says that the name of the endonuclease or restriction endonuclease would have the first alphabet from the generic name, so we take H, first two alphabets of the species name, so it becomes HIN, and the first alphabet of the code, but R has been given to echo R1 and R2 because the strain was RY13, 14 and so on. So now here we go for the second alphabet, that is D. So it is HIND. This is how the name is. Now there are Roman numbers given to it. It is written as HIND1, HIND2 and so on. The Roman numbers, that is 1, 2 and so on, are given on the basis of they are discovered. So this is on the basis of discovery. And when we read the books, it says that the first isolated endonuclease was HIND2. This means discovered one was this, then this was discovered, then HIND3 and so on. But the one which was extracted or isolated from the bacterium was this one. So the Roman numbers are given on the basis of discovery. The first discovered will have Roman number 1, then 2, then 3 and so on. But this has been written everywhere, wherever we write, first isolated. Here we are not talking about discovered. We are talking about isolated word. That means the endonuclease which was first taken out from that cell was this one. So it is HIND2, which is first isolated, and HIND1 would be the first discovered one in this particular bacteria. Pragati Sharma from Gwalior has asked this question, that why is this statement wrong, that DNA consists of 8 octamers? DNA consists of 8 octamers. Why is it wrong? Here we need to understand the meaning of octamer. If you are able to recall the structure of nucleosome, in nucleosome, there are histone proteins and we call it histone octamer. And why we call it histone octamer? Because there are 8 histone proteins. So when we are using the word octamer, we are talking about 8 proteins. So actually this is one octamer. An octamer is made up of 8 proteins. And if you start calling it 8 octamers, that means 8 protein containing one octamer. 8 such octamers are there. And that is why this statement is wrong. One octamer means something which has 8. Here, 8 histone proteins are there. 8 histone proteins make one octamer. So if you're using 8 octamers, that means you're talking of 8 such kind of structures. 8 such structures which have 8 proteins in it. And that is why this statement is wrong. Ritu from Patiala has asked this question. How many tertiary bronchi are there in right and left lung? So number of tertiary bronchi in left and right lungs. Let us quickly draw the diagram to understand how these two lungs are. The right lung is bigger and it has three lobes. We call this as superior lobe. This is the middle lobe and this is the inferior lobe. The left lung is smaller and there is a depression also, which is known as the cardiac notch, and it has only two parts, the superior lobe and inferior lobe. So these are the two lungs and their lobes. Now when the trachea divides, it gives rise to two bronchi, and we call these as primary bronchi. So this one is the primary left bronchus, which is going to enter into the left lung, and this one is known as the primary right bronchus. These bronchi, they enter into the lungs. Now, these primary bronchi, they divide to form secondary bronchi. This divides into three branches, each going into one of the lobe. So, these ones which we have drawn in black, these are the secondary bronchi. Here there are three lobes, so we have three secondary bronchi here. Secondary bronchi. So here, in case of right lung, we have three secondary bronchi. In the left one, the primary divides into two branches because each one is going to go into each lobe. So here there are two secondary bronchi. Now, in the right lung, there are 10 different compartments. It has 10 compartments, and that is why these secondary bronchi, they divide. So the first upper one, which is going into the superior one, it divides into three branches. That means here are three compartments, each one going into one compartment. This divides into two because middle lobe has two compartments, and this divides into five. So 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So here there are 10 tertiary bronchi. 5 in the inferior lobe because there are 5 compartments. Each tertiary is going into every compartment. So this 10 tertiary bronchi. And these tertiary bronchi are also known as segmental bronchus or bronchi. Reason, they are going into the segments. So here there are 10 tertiary and 3 secondary. In case of left lung, in the superior chamber or superior lobe of the lung, there are 4 compartments. So this divides into 1, 2, 3, and 4 branches. Here, actually when the lungs are formed, both have 10 compartments. But in case of left lung during development, 2 fuse here, so originally there were 5, 2 fuse, so now what remains is only 4 compartments. In this also, there are 5, 2 of them can fuse or 5 can remain separate. So here there are 4 chambers, and here there can be 4 or 5. If the fusion has taken place, then 4, and if not taken place, then 5. So we will draw 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 here. So in this case, there are total 8 or 9 tertiary bronchi. And basically, these bronchi are taking the air up to those compartments. So in right and left lung, initially there are 10 compartments. Here there are 3 lobes and 10 compartments. Here 2 lobes and 10 compartments. But as the development takes place, in the superior lobe of left lung, out of 5, 2 fuse. So 2 fuse to form 1, so total number comes to 4. In this, again there are 5, and two can fuse. If they fuse, so this will have four chambers and this will have four. So number of tertiary will come to 8. But if the four don't fuse and they remain as separate 5 compartments, and here fusion takes place. So 4 here and 5 here. So it will be 9. So number of tertiary bronchi, 10 in case of right lung and 8 or 9 in case of left lung. Rakshit Sharma from Bijnor, Uttar Pradesh has asked this question. Which is the smallest human cell? And there are three names given. So we have to see which one is the smallest. Smallest human cell. And three which are given here. One is granule cell of cerebellum. Granule cell of cerebellum. Then sperm cell. And third is RBC. Now, let us write down the sizes so that we get the clear answer. Because when we search for this, there are different places where different answers are given, and there is a reason for it. The granule cell of cerebellum, the size varies from 4 micrometers to 4.5 micrometers. Now, when we talk about the sperm cell, if we are talking about the complete length, that is from the tip of the acrosome till the tail, then it is about 50 micrometers. But if we are talking only of the head region, which is carrying the nucleus, then its size is about 5.1 micrometers. So it is very close to this. And RBCs, their diameter is about 7 micrometer, and the width is 1 to 2 micrometers. So if we compare it on the basis of the sizes, this looks the smallest. But there are many places where the sperm is also given. And if they are talking about the sperm, then they are counting only the head region, not the tail. So the size with tail is 50 micrometers. So if we are taking the complete cell, we have to take the complete structure. We cannot just take a part of it. And that is why, according to the sizes, granule cell of cerebellum is the smallest cell. The next question has been sent by Rohan from Haldwani, and the question is, why is human heart myogenic? Myogenic means when the stimulus for contraction of the heart originates from the muscle. And in case of human heart, we have studied this entire chapter of circulatory system, where we have seen the structure of heart and all. So here, when the heart contracts, the stimulus is generated by SA node, which we call the natural pacemaker of the heart. This is the natural pacemaker. And SA node is made up of specialized muscle fibers. So in case of human beings, this SA node, which is a specialized muscle fiber, this is the place from where the impulse for heart contraction or heartbeat is initiated. And that is why this heart is known as myogenic. In lower animals, where the stimulus for heart contraction originates from brain, those hearts are known as neurogenic heart. So because it is coming from the specialized muscle, we call it myogenic. Harsh from Ahmedabad has asked this question. It is about explain ART, IVF, ZIFT and GIFT. So are, and there are three parts, IVF, ZIFT, and GIFT, GIFT. ART is basically assisted reproductive techniques. When couple is not able to conceive normally, then in that case, these kind of techniques or various procedures are used so that fertilization takes place and they are able to have children in normal way. So IVF is in vitro fertilization. In this procedure, that is in vitro fertilization, the egg from the mother or the female is taken out. The sperm from the male or from a donor, they are allowed to fuse outside the body in the body-like conditions. That means everything is going to be exactly same as what are the conditions in our body. So they are allowed to fuse. That means the sperm will fertilize the egg outside our body, but in the same kind of conditions. Then that is known as in vitro fertilization. And this is done in various conditions. Say if the male is suffering from oligospermia, or when the sperm count is very less, or if there is some kind of hormonal balance, there can be many reasons for it. So fertilization is done outside the body, that is in vitro. Now, zygote intrafallopian transfer. This is zygote intrafallopian transfer. Suppose after IVF, when in vitro fertilization has taken place and the zygote is formed, now the zygote has to be put back or transplanted back into the mother's body. Now, at which stage are we trying to put it? If it is to be transported or put back into fallopian tube, then the zygote is allowed to divide to 2 to 4 celled stage, and then it is implanted or transferred into fallopian tube. If it is allowed to divide for more than 8 or around 16 cell stage, then it is directly put into uterus. Then it is known as zygote intrauterine transfer. That is ZIUT. So it totally depends on how many cells has the zygote formed after division. So if it is normally 2 to 4 cell stage, then that zygote would be put into the fallopian tube. And if it is allowed to divide for more time, 16 cell stage, 8 plus cells are formed, then it is directly put into the uterus. GIFT. This is gamete intrafallopian transfer. The name itself, or the full form itself, tells us what exactly happening. It is the gamete is actually put into the fallopian tube. So if we are putting the gamete into fallopian tube, egg is obviously coming from the ovary and the sperm can be put into the fallopian tube. So fertilization is going to take place in the fallopian tube. Zygote will be formed and normal implantation and all will be taking place. So here it is the gamete which is transferred into the fallopian tube. And all these three techniques come under ART, that is assisted reproductive techniques. Deepak Kumar has asked that if there are 120 adenine molecules in a BDNA double helical structure showing 20 coils, what is the number of pyrimidine nucleotides forming 3 hydrogen bonds in it? So let us first have the basics. BDNA, which is the common DNA that we talk of, one coil or turn has 10 base pairs. So here, So the number of base pairs would be 10 into 20 coils, that is 200 base pairs or base pairs. Base pair, when we use the word, we are talking about a pair. And according to the base pair rule, we know out of purines and pyrimidines, let us write purines and pyrimidines first. Purines are A and G, pyrimidines are C and T in case of DNA. And the base pair rule says that A pairs with T by formation of two hydrogen bonds and C pairs with G by formation of three hydrogen bonds. So now if we are talking about this, let us draw the structure. Instead of a coil, we are just drawing a straight structure. So suppose this is equivalent to say 20 coils. This entire thing is equal to 20 coil. And in 20 coil, there are 200 base pairs. But in the question, it is said that A is equal to 120. So if we say that in this DNA strands, A are at 120 places. So wherever there is A, it is going to pair with T. So there are 120 T's also. So out of 200 base pairs which are in this 20 coils, 120 are A's. And A and T, they pair with double, two hydrogen bonds. So adenine pairs with thymine to, with the help of two hydrogen bonds. So if you remove 120 from the 200 base pairs which are there in this coil, the number that remains is 80. That means, now suppose this much is covered by 120. So the remaining are 80. And here we are talking of base pairs. So these 80s could be C pairing with G, triple bonds. So how many pyrimidines are going to be there? So out of these two, C is the pyrimidine. So there would be 80 C or pyrimidine. So this question is totally based on base pair rule and the basic structure of the DNA helix. Shruti from Kerala wants to know which of the following is less general as compared to genus. And there are four options, that is species, B is division, then class, and fourth is family. Now when we classify the organisms, we can take one example. Before taking that, the topmost group is kingdom and the lowermost is species. So to understand this, that kingdom, if you're talking of say for example animalia, then all animals, whether they are vertebrates, invertebrates, whatever types, they would come into kingdom. So kingdom is like a more general kind of a thing. As you come into species, it becomes more and more specific, or in other words, less general. So here, if you talk of going from the bigger to the smaller group, it gets more specific. And the question is, which of the following is less general, or if we change that word less general to more specific, that means the one which is showing more specificity, more closeness, then the answer should be species. We'll take one example. Say if we talk of Panthera leo, Panthera pardus, and Panthera tigris. Panthera is the genus. So genus comes here. Genus and then species. So if you're talking of Leo, that means only lions. So they are even more close, more similar. So specificity is more. If we talk the type group of, if we talk about the group of tigers, tigers, they are very similar to each other. But as we come to the higher group, that is Panthera. So in Panthera genus, you are going to have lions also, leopards also, and tigers also. That means they're more general or less specific. So as we become more and more specific, that means more and more close, we come towards the bottom of it. So species would have less general or more specificity or more closely associated members. The next question has been asked by Sohail Khan from Hyderabad, Telangana. And the question is about the process of mitosis which are seen in dicot embryo development. Now this is a long process. We'll try to do it in short. This is the zygote. It is diploid. And whenever we talk of embryonic development, especially dicot or monocot embryonic development, we have to specify the sites. So this end is micropyle and the opposite end is chalaza. Zygote undergoes one mitotic division and results in formation of two cells. The cell which is towards chalaza is known as terminal cell, and the one which is towards micropyle is known as basal cell. Now we will change the color code. Basal cell we'll make with a different color so that whatever structure comes from the basal cell will be drawn in different color. Basal cell undergoes division only on one plane, which are called periclinal division. And this results in formation of a chain of cells. This chain of cells is known as suspensor. And the lowermost cell, that means the cell which is towards micropyle, is slightly swollen and is known as haustorial cell. And this complete structure is called suspensor. The function of suspensor is to push the embryo deeper into the nutritive tissue. Now, the terminal cell, it divides. It divides in all planes. So first division if is vertical, second is going to be horizontal. This results in formation of a four-celled state. This is actually a proembryo. It will give rise to embryo. So we call it proembryonal. And as there are only four cells, we call it quadrant. Now, these cells, they divide one more time. And here, we start seeing eight cells. Now, the cells are not arranged like this. The cells are arranged in the form of a mass. But because we want to understand which cell gives rise to which part, this is how we draw it. Here there are eight cells, so we call it proembryonal octant, as there are eight cells. Now, one cell of the suspensor, which is in contact with this proembryo, it becomes bigger. And we start calling it hypophysis. So this is hypophysis. Hypophysis has developed from one of the cells of the suspensor, the one which is in contact with the proembryo. So this is the one which is going to give rise to the hypophysis. Hypophysis also divides to form eight cells. Again, we are drawing it like this because we want to understand what part of the embryo comes from which cell. And the suspensor is as it is in the form of a chain of cells. Only thing is, now it starts looking little smaller because the embryo is getting bigger. The proembryonal octant now undergoes a periclinal division. A periclinal means now it divides along the periphery. Each cell divides, so there is a peripheral cell, one inner, one outer, one inner. So this is how the number of cells are increasing. This is the proembryo. Now we start calling it proembryo. Hypophysis, there are already four cells here. So let us draw this hypophysis. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 cells here. And our suspensor of the embryo is still there in the form of this small structure now. Now, this embryonal stage is known as globular stage. Reason why is it called globular is it is a mass of the cells. So we start calling it globular embryo. Globular embryo. Because this is going to divide and divide and a spherical mass would be formed. Now, the cells which are on the upper part of this proembryo, they are the ones which are actually going to give rise to the cotyledons. So now, I'm going to change the same structure so that the next stage is visible. These cells are going to divide and they will produce cotyledons. So when these cells divide, we start seeing the structure growing like this from here also and from here also. Here is going to be the plumule that is going to develop. So because of this, now if we remove all these cells from here, the shape becomes heart-like. So after globular embryo, we start calling it heart-shaped embryo. So the upper part of the embryonal structure, that is the mass, gives rise to the cotyledons plus plumule plus epicotyle. The lower half is going to give rise to the hypocotyle. Now, these cells, that is of hypophysis, they are the ones which are going to produce the root, root cortex, root cap. So, these cells, when they divide, we start seeing this root-like structure. There is no enough space for these cotyledons to grow. So, these cotyledons, they bend towards either side. So, the same heart-shaped embryo will change into now horseshoe shaped embryo. How is that going to happen? Again, I'm changing the same diagram. So let us erase this. Now these cotyledons, they're going to bend. So this cotyledon, it bends towards this side. This cotyledon, it bends like this. And this cotyledon is also going to bend here. So now the shape is, these cotyledons have bent on one side. If we remove this, we see a different shape. This is known as horseshoe shaped embryo. So there are three stages of this embryo. First, it is going to be just a mass. So this is stage number one, which we call globular embryo. Then from the upper part of that embryonal knob or embryonal cluster of the cells, cotyledons start forming, so there are two bulges which we see, and the shape becomes heart shaped. So this is stage number two. And as the cotyledons don't have enough space there, they bend towards one side. And now the shape is horseshoe like. So this is how there are three stages of the embryo which are formed in this case of dicot plants. Vani Kaushik from Saharanpur, UP asks, what is the function of interstitial cell stimulating hormone in human male reproductive system? In testes, which are the main or primary reproductive organs in case of males, if we take a section, there are many seminiferous tubules which are cut. And in these tubules, the sperm production or the spermatogenesis process is taking place. The tissue which is in between these is known as interstitial tissue. And in this tissue are present the cells which are known as interstitial cells or Leydig's cells. The hormone is ICSH, interstitial cell stimulating hormone. And these interstitial cells are Leydig's cells, which is the specific name given to them after the scientist's name, but they are also known as interstitial cells because they are found in this interstitial fluid. So ICSH is going to stimulate Leydig cells to secrete androgens. Androgens are the male sex hormones, and the most important of these is testosterone. So when we talk of ICSH, interstitial cell stimulating hormone, it is going to stimulate interstitial cells. Interstitial cells are Leydig, are also known as Leydig cells, and when they are stimulated, androgens or the male sex hormones are secreted. Umang Bhatia from Delhi has sent this question: why myelinated nerve fibers conduct impulse faster than the non-myelinated? When we talk of the structure of neurons, we say that there is a cell body, and from the cell body there are many thread-like structures which are the dendrites, and one long fiber which is the axon, and this axon terminates by end bulbs. The axon in this cell body, this is cyton or cell body, which has the nucleus, nissl, granules and all those things. On this axon is present myelin sheath. This myelin sheath is secreted by Schwann cells, and many a times that's why we draw here the cells associated with it. So this is Schwann cell and this is myelin sheath. Myelin sheath acts as an insulator. So when the impulse is conducted on this, and impulse is nothing but charges. So if there is an insulating layer, then the charges are going to travel or move wherever this insulating layer is not there. These areas where this myelin sheath is absent are known as nodes of Ranvier. So now, if the impulse has to travel on this nerve fiber or on this axon, this is one place where the charge can be found. Again, an insulating layer, and here the charge can be found. That means it is going to jump from this point to this point. That is from one node of Ranvier to the next. Then from here to here and so on. Such type of conduction is known as saltatory conduction. Saltatory conduction. Saltare is to leap, to take a jump. That is known as saltare. So saltatory conduction is basically when the impulse jumps from one node of Ranvier to the next. So this much distance is going to be covered in shorter period of time. In contrast, if we draw another neuron where this myelin sheath is, say, not there. So this is going to be the axon and its end bulbs. No myelin sheath. So the charge is here. So charge is going to move from this point to the next point, from here to the next point, from here to the next point. So it's going to take time before it reaches the place of response or place of organ where some function has to be done. And that is why the nerve impulse conduction is faster in case of myelinated nerve. Myelinated nerves are those in which the axons have myelin sheath. Areas where myelin is missing are called nodes of Ranvier, and the impulse jumps from one node to the next. Such type of conduction is saltatory conduction, and it is faster, and that is why on myelinated nerves conduction is faster. The next question which I have has been asked by Tushar from Punjab, and the question is, mention the phylum along with one example with reference to the distinctive features mentioned below. There are five features mentioned, so let us write down those features here. The first one is water vascular system. The second is Malpighian tubules. Malpighian tubules. Third character is needleblasts. Needleblasts are present. And fourth, triploblastic acoelomate. Triploblastic acoelomate animals. And the last one is bioluminescence and chromplates. Now we have to answer. There are three things which are asked on this. Number one, we need to mention the phylum to which these type of organisms or animals belong. Phylum, one example of each, and the last is the significance or importance of these characters. So let us take this. What are vascular system? It is a characteristic feature of echinoderms. So the phylum in which it is found is Echinodermata. An example, most common example that we talk of is starfish. There are many, but we are just citing one. Now, water vascular system, what are the role, what is the special thing about it? So it helps in locomotion. It also helps in transport of food and respiratory gases. Transport of food and gases, so that exchange of gases can take place. The second structure, that is Malpighian tubule, these are excretory structures which are found in arthropods. So the phylum is Arthropoda. And example that we can take is of cockroach. And the function of Malpighian tubules is excretion. The next are needleblasts. Needleblasts are stinging cells, and they are characteristic feature of organisms like Hydra. They are present on the tentacles of Hydra. So example is Hydra, and it belongs to Cnidaria or Coelenterata. Cnidaria, or there is one more name, Coelenterata. And as I said, they are stinging organs, so they help in defense. So they are stinging cells which help in defense of the animal. Now, triploblastic acoelomate. Triploblastic means there are three germ layers. So meaning of triploblastic, that means their body develops from three germ layers. These three germ layers are ectoderm, mesoderm and endoderm. Acoelomate, coelome term is given to body cavity. Acoelome means they do not have body cavities. No body cavity. And that's why they are called acoelomates. The animals which have these two characteristics, they belong to Platyhelminthes. And the example is tapeworm, tinea solium, liver fluke and all. So they are known as flatworms because their bodies are absolutely flat. Now, the last point is bioluminescence and chromplates. Now, this is bioluminescence is a property when the organism can glow in dark. So, they glow in dark. Now, how do they do it? They keep absorbing various wavelengths during the daytime and emit them in darkness. So, they glow basically in dark. Chromplates are rows of cilia which help them in locomotion. Rows of cilia which help them in locomotion. And this is again a characteristic feature of Ctenophora. Ctenophora is the group in which there are two important characteristic features. That is, they have complex, that is, the rows of cilia which help them in locomotion, and they show bioluminescence. So on these points, we can compare all these organisms. Shabnam Sana has asked, what is sticky and blunt ends? Now, sticky and blunt ends are observed whenever a palindrome is cut with the help of endonucleases. So if we write a palindrome, so a palindrome is a sequence of nucleotides on a double-stranded DNA which reads the same when we read in the opposite direction. So if we make a palindrome here, say we write AA, these are the nucleotides, G, C, T and T. This is one thread, one strand of DNA. The polarity is 5 prime, 3 prime. Its complementary strand is going to have AA, because T pairs with A, C pairs with G, G would pair with C, A is going to pair with T and again T. Here the polarity, because they are anti-parallel, is going to be 5 prime and 3 prime. So when we say a palindrome, it is a nucleotide sequence which reads the same on both the strands, read in the same direction. So if you are reading it from 5 prime towards 3 prime, it reads as AAGCTT. Again, 5, 2, 3 prime, AAGCTT. It is reading the same when we are reading it in the same direction on both the strands. So if we read it like this, it is AAGCTT, AAGCTT. We can do it in the opposite direction. If we read it from third end, it is going to be TTCGAA, TTCGAA. So these are palindromes. Now palindromes can be cut by endonucleases in two ways. Suppose we take one situation. In one situation, the endonuclease is cutting between G and C. Say it cuts between G and C. So here the bond will be broken, the phosphodiester bond, and here also the bond will be broken. So here we write endonuclease cuts between G and C. So after the strand gets cut, how are the two pieces going to look? After it gets cut, we will get a piece AAG. So this is going to be AAG, and the other piece will have CTT, CTT. So this is how one strand gets cut. The lower strand, its complementary one, will have TTC here, because it is getting cut from this point, and the other one will have GAA. And now the polarity, this end was 5 prime, so this will be 5, this becomes third, this will be 5, this becomes third. Here also, this end is 3, so this will be 5, this will be 3 and 5. Now here, the length of both the strands after they have been cut is equal. It is like, suppose we are holding these two strands, and when we cut them, the length of the two strands is equal. Such ends are known as blunt ends. Blunt ends, where the length of the DNA, both the strands, is equal, then that would be called blunt end. Now, if we take another situation, say an endonuclease is there, and that endonuclease cuts between A and G. So suppose this is the place where it is going to cut. So it will cut between A and G. This strand will get cut here, and the other strand is going to get cut here, because the endonuclease cuts between G and A. This is where the endonuclease is acting on the same palindrome. So after this gets cut, the upper strand will have AA, because here it's only A and A, And the other one, because it is getting cut between A and G, the other one will have G, C, T, and T. The lower strand will get cut like this because again it is getting cut between G and A. So it will have T, T, C, G, T, T, C, G. And the other end here is going to have A and A. So is the length of two strands equal in this case? It is not. So if we talk of this strand, this is smaller, this is longer. In this piece, this one is longer, this one is shorter. Such kind of ends are known as sticky ends, or they are also known as cos sides. Cos sides. Both the ends are used for rDNA technology, but more commonly it is the sticky ends because it lets that desired gene come and bind easily. Because if this is the strand, the desired gene can come and bind at CNG by hydrogen bonds, and here it can join by making phosphodiester bond. So these are the two types of cuts which we get when different types of endonucleases work on palindromes. The next question has been asked by Abhilash George. And the question is, what type of plant is formed when colchicine is used in the process of development of Raphanobrassica? And there are four options given: triploid, haploid, autotetraploid, and allotetraploid. Now here we need to understand what are polyploids first. Polyploid term is used when the number of chromosomes, it increases by a set. Here, number of chromosomes increase by a set. And when we use the word set, we are talking of one set of chromosome which we represent by N. So one set means N. And that is why when we write N, we say haploid. When we write two sets, that is 2N, we write it diploid. When we write 3N, we call it triploid. And when normally the numbers of sets are more than 3, 4N or more, then we start calling them polyploids. This is one part. Now, in case of Raphanobrassica, which is a hybrid, so first understand the process of formation of this hybrid. It was obtained by crossing Raphanus satiam, that is reddish, and Brassica oleracea, that is the cabbage. Now, when we talk about Raphanobrassica, it was between the genus Raphanus and genus Brassica. To understand this, we will use alphabets. Raphanus has 2N set of chromosome. It is a normal diploid plant. So we write it as RR, R for Raphanus. And here we would use B, keeping Brassica in mind. Now when they reproduce, they would produce gametes. The gamete would have one of the two, that is one set, out of two, one. So gametes are haploid. So this gamete is going to bring B. Now when fusion was done, it was R and B. It again got diploid. One set from Raphanus, other set from Brassica. But it was sterile. Now these plants were treated with colchicine. Colchicine treatment helps in increase in the number of sets. The reason is when the chromosomes are double and spindle fibers are not formed, then they do not get separated into two cells. So in the same cell, the chromosome number is going to double. So if we talk about R, this one set, it would also get double. So here there would be two R's. There was one B. with Kolchicine, that cell also replicated, so this also got B. Here, we have a situation like polyploids. We have to remember that R is like one set, the other R is also one set, B is also one set, and this is also one set. Only reason we have picked R and B so that we can remember that one set is coming from Raphanus, other set is coming from Brassica. So, here we have a polyploid. Is it the same set of the same species multiplying? Had it been R, 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 we would have called it autoploid. And how many sets are there? Four. We would have called autotetraploid. Same situation. If it would have been B, B, B and D, we would have again called it autotetraploid, because it is the set of the same species which is increasing every time, four times here. Here, there are two of Raphanus and two of Brassica. So, it is definitely a polyploid and there are four sets. So, it is a tetrapolyploid. But, are all four sets from the same genus or species in this case? The answer is no. So, here they are allotetraploid. So, and this plant was Raphanobrassica. The hybrid which was obtained by crossing Raphanus and Brassica. So, polyploids, more than normal number of sets. Autopolyploid, when the set of the same species increases, and if there are two different species or genera where their sets have combined and their number is increasing. Here, every alphabet is representing one set. So, four sets, so tetra. And obviously, it is polyploid, so it is tetrapolyploid. Tetrapolyploid. And it is allo because two sets are of one plant and two sets are of other plant. So, it is allotetraploid, or we can also call it allotetrapolyploid. But tetra is again same thing. So, we don't have to mention tetrapolyploid. It is allotetraploid. Apoorv Tyagi has asked, what is the most common respiratory substrate in plants? Now, respiratory substrate is that material or that molecule with which the respiratory process starts. So, respiratory substrate invariably is carbohydrate. And the reason why it is carbohydrate is, whether it is aerobic respiration or anaerobic respiration, the first step is always glycolysis. So, it is carbohydrate. It can be broken down aerobically as well as anaerobically. So, carbohydrates. But, in certain situations, even proteins and fats, they also act as respiratory surface. But if we have to pick which one out of all three, this is going to be carbohydrate. Reason, two reasons. First step is glycolysis. Glycolysis takes place in cytoplasm where glucose gets broken down into pyruvic acid. If oxygen is available, it will undergo all the other steps of aerobic respiration, that is Krebs cycle and all. And if oxygen is absent, then either ethyl alcohol formation would take place in yeast or lactic acid in muscle cell. So, first step is always glycolysis, which starts with glucose. Second, carbohydrates have RQ, that is respiratory quotient of 1. Now, can other substances be also used as respiratory substrate? The answer is yes, but those are situation based. If carbohydrate is not available, or if the reserve food material is only protein or only fat, then proteins and fats can also be used. So, we are writing can also be used. That means it is not the primary respiratory substrate. And the reason is that fats and proteins have RQ less than 1. So this is the most important reason why these are not the most important or the primary respiratory substrate. RQ actually helps us find out how much oxygen is required and carbon dioxide ratio. So this is the perfect number, and that is why carbohydrates are the main or the primary respiratory substrates. Chahat from Jammu has a question here. What type of interaction exists between sea anemone and hermit crab? Is it symbiosis or commensalism? So let us define these two things first. Symbiosis is a mutual interrelationship, mutual relationship between two organisms where both get benefited. Both get benefited. This is important. Now, if we talk about commensalism, in this association, it is also mutual, but one gets benefited, but the other one is not harmed. One gets the benefit. The other not harmed. So here we are talking of an interaction or a relationship between two organisms. Here the relationship is such that both will get benefited. Whereas in case of commensalism, one gets benefited, other is neither harmed nor getting benefited. So it's basically a neutral thing. In case of this association between hermit crab and sea anemone, that is Adamsia, the interaction or the relationship between them is hermit crab lives in the empty shells of mollusks. So this one lives in empty shells. And sea anemone grows on the shell. Grows on the shell. Now, what is the benefit to this hermit crab? Hermit crab is living inside the shell and the sea anemone is growing on that shell. Sea anemone has tentacles with stinging organs. So now if any predator approaches the hermit crab, because of those tentacles of sea anemone, hermit crab is protected. So benefit is definitely there for hermit crab. So hermit crab is definitely getting benefited. Let us talk about sea anemone. Sea anemones are sedentary animals. They remain at one place. They remain attached at the substratum. It could be a rock, it could be a shell also. That means if they remain attached to a rock, whatever food comes with the water current, only that much is available to them. But if it is on the shell, hermit crab is moving around. And when hermit crab is moving around along with that, even sea anemone is also moving around. That means sea anemone gets a larger area to feed from. Plus, whatever hermit crab feeds on and whatever is left over, those smaller pieces, those are collected by the tentacles of sea anemone and it also gets. So here we see both getting benefited. Hermit crab gets the protection because of the stinging cells which are present on the tentacles of sea anemone. And sea anemone gets to cover a larger area for gathering of food. So this association between these two organisms is symbiosis because both are getting benefited. Kanai Mitra from West Bengal has a question on lactational amenorrhea. Lactational amenorrhea is actually a period immediately after the childbirth when the female is lactating. At that time, there is no chance of her conceiving again. So it is a temporary phase of infertility. Temporary phase of infertility. And that is when she is lactating. So this is during lactation. This lactational amenorrhea, it normally lasts for 6 months. This is the most common period when this lactational amenorrhea is seen. But there's a wide range. There are certain females in which a menstrual cycle resumes immediately after parturition. In some cases, it extends for a longer period, up to a year or a little more than that. So the most common period where this lactational amenorrhea lasts is 6 months. Now what happens? And let us understand the meaning of this word. Amenorrhea basically means suspension in menstruation. There is no menstruation. Now basically, what is happening is during breastfeeding, this menstrual cycle is not normalized, or the hormonal levels are not normalized. So when the female is breastfeeding, there is decrease in the secretion of gonadotropin releasing hormone from hypothalamus, and this would ultimately result in decrease in the level of LH. So if LH is not there, because if you are able to recall the menstrual cycle, around 14th day there is LH surge, where the concentration of LH increases, and that results into rupturing of graafian follicle and release of the egg or secondary oocyte, which we say. So if LH level is not more or sufficient, then the follicles are not going to rupture. And if follicle doesn't rupture either, there is no ovulation, or the follicle undergoes atresia. Atresia means it basically shrinks. If follicle doesn't rupture, because the egg is released, after that the remaining part of the graafian follicle is going to change into corpus luteum. So the entire cycle gets disturbed. And as there is no ovulation, there is no chance of this female getting pregnant again. Because of that, we call it a temporary phase of infertility. This question has been asked by Hemant Chauhan. And the question is, what do you mean by back cross and why is it done? Back cross is defined as crossing of an organism with one of the parent. Crossing with one of the parent. And normally the parent which is selected in this cross is homozygous dominant. So this is the back cross. Now normally when we define it, it is crossing of an organism with one of the parent. Now if we go according to Mendelian way of genetics, it always starts with pure line. So first, that is parent generation, is pure dominant crossed with pure recessive. So here we need to specify that for back cross, the genotype which is selected of the parent is homozygous dominant. There is one type of back cross which is known as test cross that I'll tell you after some time. Back cross is performed to improve the breed. This is done to improve the breed. Now, we'll take an example. Suppose we have a short sugarcane plant. Say the sugarcane plant is short. And we know that the complete sugar or sucrose which is stored is in the stem part. So if it is short, the height of that plant is less, it obviously is going to have less sucrose accumulated in it. I want the next generation plants to be all tall. So we cross this with homozygous dominant, one of the parent which is homozygous dominant. This produces the gametes with recessive, and this would produce gametes with the dominant one. If we plot the Punnett square, what we see is here the gametes are all dominant and here are recessive. So all four are going to be heterozygous and they all will be taught phenotypically. This is going to be taught because now it has received one dominant allele. So all four are going to be taught. So though I had an initial short plan, by back crossing it with one of the parent, which is homozygous dominant, the breed of the next generation, that is in this case F1, has been improved. So if all sugarcane plants become tall, the sucrose content stored will also be more, the productivity is going to increase. Now there is a variation from this back cross. It is also a type of back cross, but in that case, the parent is homozygous recessive. If that is the situation, then that type of back cross is known as test cross. So what is a test cross? It is a type of back cross in which the organism is crossed with one of the parent and the parent is homozygous recessive. So it is a type of back cross. And if it is only back cross, this is what is considered as back cross, and we use it or perform it to improve the breed. Kali Prasad Rai from Noida has asked this question: why insulin is not given orally to a diabetic patient? Insulin is a protein, and if a proteinaceous thing, say for example insulin, if it is taken orally, then we know that in our stomach there are strong proteolytic enzymes. So these enzymes would break down that insulin and it would not get absorbed. Insulin is going to work only when it is in the blood and then it reaches that target structure where it can function. Aditya Chauhan has a question: what are the techniques to prevent self-pollination? We can call it techniques to prevent self-pollination or techniques to favor cross-pollination. These plants which favor cross-pollination want to prevent self-pollination. They show various kinds of adaptations. Let us talk about some adaptations. Adaptations to prevent self-pollination. First adaptation which we can talk of is the plants would be dioecious. Dioecious means one plant would have only one type of sex organ. So either it's going to be a male plant separately having only male flowers. Male flowers are known as staminate flower, and if flower is going to produce only the male reproductive structure or gamete, then self-pollination is not possible because in that plant, on that flower, the female reproductive part is not at all there, and the other is going to be the female plant and it is going to produce only female flowers. Such flowers are known as pistillate flowers. So here only the female reproductive part would be there and only female gamete would be produced. This is seen in case of plants which are dioecious. For example, date palm. So there is a male, even papaya. Male plant is separate, female plant is separate. So there is no scope of self-pollination. The second adaptation is dichogamy. Dichogamy. Dichogamy is if the plant has bisexual or hermaphrodite flowers. That means both male and female reproductive structures are present on the same flower. Then they show this dichogamy. That is, maturation of one sex organ will take place first and the second one would not have matured by that time. So if it is male part developing first, we call it protandrous. And if female part develops first, it is known as protogynous. So this is, again, one plant having same two structures, male reproductive, female reproductive. Male reproductive structure develops, the pollen grains are formed, but the egg is not ready. So even if the pollen falls on the stigma, it will not be able to germinate and fertilize. That means this self-pollination will not take place. Third adaptation is heterostyle. Heterostyle is, in certain plants like oxalis, there are two or three types of flowers which are produced. One flower where the style is long and the filaments are short. That means this stigma is going to be exposed to receive the pollen grains from other flower. And the pollen grains of the same flower, they would not be able to reach here. These kind of flowers are known as pin flowers. The second type of flowers which they have is short style and long filament, and anthers are exposed. So when they rupture, the pollen grains fall on the outer side. Such flowers are known as thrum. And third type of flowers which they have are the normal flowers, in which the length of stigma, length of style and filament is pretty much same. These adaptations are seen that in case if cross-pollination fails, they reproduce by self-pollination. So this is also an adaptation which is seen in case of oxalis. Another adaptation is actually harcogamy. Harcogamy is seen in Calotropis. In Calotropis, all the pollen grains are packed into a structure. There is a physical barrier and the structure are called pollinia. So there are these two balloon-like structures. All the pollen grains are inside these pollinia. These are called pollinia. And pollen grains are here. So if the pollinium of the same plant falls on the stigma, say it falls on this stigma, there is a physical barrier, there is a membrane of this pollinium which does not let the pollen grain come in contact with stigma. So this is also an adaptation. Then there are certain genetic adaptations like self-incompatibility. So let us write this fifth one here. Self-incompatibility. That means if the pollen grain of the same plant comes and falls on the stigma of the same flower or same plant, it will not germinate. So by using any of these different adaptations, plants have prevented self-pollination, or they favor cross-pollination. Animesh Dash from Odisha has asked this question, and the question is, calculate the number of ATPs synthesized when 10 amino acids get deaminated and enter the respiratory pathways. So number of ATP from 10 amino acids after deamination. So now, when amino acids get deaminated, that means that amino group is removed, amino acid would change into multiple things. But the most common product that we get is alpha-ketoglutarate. And if you remember Krebs cycle, you can go to the playlist of cellular respiration chapter. I have explained the complete Krebs cycle there. So if you go there, you will find various substances in that sequence. So I'm writing it in short so that we can calculate oxaloacetic acid accepts acetyl coenzyme A and forms citric acid. Then it changes into isocitric acid, alpha keto glutarate. Then succinyl coenzyme A, then succinic acid, then fumaric acid, malic acid, and oxaloacetic acid. Now here, when we talk of all these things, I have also given a simple formula or simple trick to remember Krebs cycle. That is C, I, no, some simple formula making options. So it is easier for you to remember the sequence. Now we have to also remember the number of reactions. We call this number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8. And in 3 steps, which are redox reactions, that is reaction number 3, 4 and 8. NADH2 is going to get produced. NADH2. This is what we require when we have to calculate the ATPs that are produced. In step number 5, we get one GTP synthesized, which is equivalent to one ATP. And in reaction number 6, which is also a redox reaction, we get FADH2. You can understand this in complete detail when you read that or when you watch that video on Krebs cycle. But just to calculate, and as we said, this is going to change into alpha ketoglutarate. That means it is going to join here. This is the place where amino acid after deamination is going to join the respiratory pathway that is in Krebs cycle. Now let us count the number of ATPs. One NADH2 is worth 3 ATPs. One FADH2 is worth 2 ATPs. So this is going to give us 3. GTP ATP 1. So this is 1. FADH2 is going to give us 2. And this is going to give us 3. So if 1 alpha ketoglutarate joins here, we get 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 and 9. One amino acid into one alpha keto glutarate gives us 9 ATPs. And the question is, if 10 amino acids join this pathway, it is going to be 10 into 9, that is 90 ATPs. This is when we are taking the most common substance that we obtain after deamination. To calculate such kind of things, and these are the type of questions which are asked in competitive exam where we don't have the time to draw the complete cycle and write all the names. This is where the tricks help, so that we are able to immediately write that reaction number 3, 4 and 8, NADH2 is produced. Reaction number 5, one ATP is there. Reaction number 6, one FADH2 is there. So we quickly are able to calculate the number of ATPs synthesized. This question has been sent by Chumke Sarkar from Kota, Rajasthan. The question is, a woman with albinic father marries an albinic man. Let us write down the genotypes of this. If a female, because it starts, the question starts with a woman whose father is albinic. That means she has received, these are the parents that we are talking of this woman, and the father is albino. And albinism is a recessive disorder. So unless and until the individual has both the recessive alleles, this albinism would not be expressed. That means this female has received one recessive allele. And because nothing is mentioned about her being albinic, we are talking of her as heterozygous. That means she has one dominant allele and one recessive allele. This female marries an albinic man. So the man she marries is albinic. And there are four options given what would be the genotypes of the offsprings. So if we plot a Punnett square, the gametes produced by the man would be recessive containing, and the gametes produced by the female would be one recessive, one dominant. So here it's going to be heterozygous in this case, and these are going to be homozygous. That means these two will be normal, though they have the recessive allele, but due to presence of this dominant allele, melanin production will take place and they would have normal skin color. Whereas these two, they are not having any dominant allele, and that's why they're going to be albino. So these two are normal and two are albino. So we can write the ratio as 2:2, or we can simplify it as 1:1. So in this question, the last option, which says one albinic and one normal, this is what is going to be the correct possible option. Kumar Kanishk from Betiha, Bihar has a question here, and it is about a genotype is given, and the question is about how many different types of sperms would be produced by this individual, another genotype of the female. Let me write the genotypes here. The male has a genotype of capital E, capital E, capital F, recessive, capital G, small g, and H and H. And the female has a genotype here, I and recessive, L both dominant, M heterozygous, and N also heterozygous. The question is, how many types of sperms would this male produce? Types of sperms. And here, how many different types of eggs would this female produce? Now, whenever we want to know the number of or types of gametes, there is a very simple formula. And the formula is 2^n. N here is the number of genes which are in heterozygous condition. So here, if we talk of, this is heterozygous and this is heterozygous. So in this case, it becomes 2^2. So 2 into 2, here there would be 4 different types of gametes produced. In this case, this is heterozygous, this is also hetero, and this is also hetero. So here, the formula will be 2^3. That means 2 into 2 into 2. That would be 8 different types of gametes. This is by simple formula. But if we really want to understand how these 4 types of gametes are formed by other method, then also we can take our understanding. What we have to do is, during gamete formation, the number of genes is going to get reduced to half. So, one of this, one of this, one of this, and one of this. Let us make these 4 possible combinations. One of this, capital E, there is no other option. Capital F, that is dominant, let us take capital G and H. So this is one type. Second, E anyways is dominant. Let us take F dominant and G recessive. H anyways is dominant. So out of these two, we have taken one dominant and other recessive. We'll flip this now. So E, F recessive, G dominant and H, third possibility. And the fourth possibility is, let us take both recessive this time. So it is F, G and H. Here we have taken both dominant. There is no question with E and H because they are all same. So both dominant, F dominant, G recessive. Here we have flipped F recessive, G dominant and all recessive. So whether we find it out by the formula or by this method, either ways, we get the number of gametes which are produced by that particular organism. Pranav Jamwal from Jammu and Kashmir has sent this question. And the question is, why we get more proteins from SCP, that is single cell. We call them single cell proteins. So SCPs, why do we get it more from microorganisms? The reason is because of their high biomass production capacity. Now this we can understand by a very simple example. If there is a 250 kilogram cow and it produces milk, that entire milk which this cow produces would have 200 grams of protein, and that is per day, right? The entire milk which the cow produces in a day would contain 200 grams of proteins. But if we just culture or grow 250 grams of microbes, like a simple microbe like Methylophilus, then only this 250 gram of microbe in the same duration, that is one day, can produce 25 tons of protein per day. So with the increase in population, if we have to supply that much of protein, and not only this, if we are growing or nurturing these cows, we have to take care of the shelter, their immunization, their health, everything, food which is to be given to them, and only 200 grams of protein per day. Whereas 250 grams of microbes, this can be grown in a beaker or a few petri dishes in a small lab, and we are able to produce tons of proteins in just the same duration of time. And that is why single cell proteins are preferred whenever we want to have these protein content ready. Tushar from Punjab has asked this question, and there is a diagram which is here, and there's a question related to the diagram. The diagram is like of urinary bladder. The urethra is opening and there are a few dots here which are showing or labeled as stretch receptor. This tube is urethra, and here are the two sphincters. This is internal urethral sphincter. And this is the external sphincter. So, and the question is role of sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system on micturition. Role of sympathetic nervous system and parasympathetic nervous system on micturition. Micturition is voiding of urine. Now let us understand this process, what exactly causes this micturition. Micturition is a reflex action. Whenever the bladder is slightly more than 50% full, the wall of bladder stretches. The wall is made up of detrusor muscles. These are smooth muscles. Now, whenever the bladder gets more than 50% full, these stretch receptors perceive that stretching of the wall. And then, because of reflex, the muscles, they contract. And here, it is parasympathetic nervous system which is working. This is a normal condition. In normal condition, the detrusor muscles contract. And when this is the first point which is going to happen, the muscles are going to contract. There are two sphincters. The internal sphincter is made up of smooth muscle. Which is going to relax. So, internal sphincter relaxes. When it relaxes, it opens. And the external sphincter, it is made up of skeletal or voluntary muscles that is under the control of a person. So first, when the bladder is almost half or slightly more than half full, the stretch receptors. They are going to get stimulated. After that, the parasympathetic nervous system is going to work. Detrusor muscles are going to contract. That means the bladder contracts. The internal sphincter is going to relax. When the sphincter relaxes, it opens. And the external one is under the control of our will. So this is a voluntary thing. Sympathetic nervous system normally works in stress situation. And all sympathetic nerves, they have neurotransmitter adrenaline. So whenever sympathetic nervous system works, the detrusor muscles, they relax. Detrusor muscles relax. Or we can call the bladder relaxes. And many a times, the person is not able to control urine under stress situation. But under normal situation, the stimulus would be received when the bladder is half or more than half full, and it is sympathetic nervous system which is going to work. Sympathetic works under normal conditions. In stress situations, when adrenaline is there, sympathetic nervous system works in all stress conditions. That is the time when the muscles totally relaxes and the person loses total control on that bladder. So this is how the two systems regulate the process of micturition. So we have come to an end of the video number 2 of our Q&A series. I have tried to take as many as questions I could in this time period. And if your question has not been included, you can repost that question in the comment box of this video. And those questions will be taken and that video will be uploaded on March 6th. That is again a Monday. And one more point which I wanted to discuss here. The questions which you're asking should be like a small question, a concept, or a small point which is not clear, instead of asking an entire process. Because if I keep discussing just one process, that entire 30 minute, 40 minute duration would be used up in that process. So just ask small questions which can be covered in 2 to 3 minutes time, so that I'm able to take care of more and more questions in this time period.